Nice to have you along with us. We were hoping you'd work us in this morning. Welcome to Studio One, here to make the start of your day a bit more informative and entertaining. I'm Tom Buring with an interesting hour ahead of us. And speaking of entertaining, how about Sioux basketball? Both UND men's and women's are at the top of their conferences and divisional rankings. What a year the program is having. They host Morningside tonight and the University of South Dakota tomorrow. Men's coach Rich Glas, women's coach Jean Roebuck both join us this morning. And on today's technology page, a report about concern over our shrinking resources for scientific research. Later in our second half hour, John Odegard and the country's best aviation training and Canada's foremost fashion maverick Peter Nygaard. First in the news desk where we get good news and a major breakthrough in the Middle East with more details on that and other news, Ann Curian joins us. Good morning, Ann.
Good morning, Tom. Iraq has announced what appears to be a major breakthrough to halt the Persian Gulf War. Just minutes ago, CNN reported that the Iraqi Revolutionary Command Council has announced it will withdraw from Kuwait. An Associated Press translation of an Iraqi radio broadcast says that Iraq will comply with the United Nations resolution to achieve a dignified and acceptable settlement of the war. The U.S. State Department says it has not received any independent confirmation of the broadcast. The Iraqi council, headed by Saddam Hussein, appeared to link its proposed pullout with Kuwait from a resolution of Arab status in Israeli-occupied areas. The U.S. and its allies have previously rejected all attempts to link the pullout with the Israeli issue. Meanwhile, as Iraqis celebrated the news in Baghdad, the U.S. Defense Department said it planned no attempt to halt its attacks on Iraq. More heated debate is expected today as the United Nations Security Council resumed its closed-door session on the Gulf War. At the urging of the United States and its allies, the session was closed to the press, the first such closure in 16 years. The council says it wants to avoid seeming divided. Meanwhile, U.S. officials say President Bush is planning to ask Congress for $56 billion to cover costs for the first 3 months of the war. The U.S. hopes much of that amount will be repaid by the allies, who so far have promised to contribute $51 billion. And in another development, Iraq has denied reports that many of the people reported killed in the bombing of a bunker in Baghdad were high Iraqi leaders and their families. Iraq claims as many as 500 civilians died in the attack. The U.S. says the structure was one of 10 communication centers it has targeted in Iraq. As most of you know or should have known, Valentine's Day came and went yesterday. Those who remembered were faced with the task of finding the perfect gift for their sweetheart. Studio One reporter Michelle Gustafson found one place where anyone's sweet tooth could be satisfied.
In the heart of downtown Grand Forks stands one of the sweetest and busiest businesses around, especially this time of year. The place is Widman's Candy Shop, known for its homemade candy. And when Valentine's Day gets near, customers keep coming and going.
This is where I always come to buy for my wife and my kids.
What are you going to get them?
Candy.
Like what?
Doesn't everybody buy candy?
Who are you buying for?
For my wife and two kids.
Getting a present for my husband. I hope he doesn't see this.
Well, I'm buying something for him and he's buying something for me. Isn't that nice? After 46 years.
Okay, who are you buying for?
My wife.
What are you going to get her?
Whatever is good. I don't know what to get.
And Widman's customers do have a hard time choosing because there is such a large variety of candy available. The possibilities seem endless, from standard heart-shaped boxes, to platters, to chocolate koala bears, and even roses you can eat. To some, it's just chocolate, but to the owner, George Widman, it's much more.
Chocolate is a science, you see. You know, you buy it on whatever merit you want it. You know, color, taste, viscosity, fineness, everything, you see. And that's how you do it. And we think that we got the best chocolate for the money that there is.
Valentine's Day may be a busy time of year here at Widman's, but everyone agrees that chocolate tastes good any day of the year. This is Michelle Gustafson reporting for Studio One News.
Until now, North Dakota residents had to cross the state border to shop on Sundays. But when Governor George Sinner signed the Sunday opening law, North Dakota history was made. Retailers can now be open on Sunday from noon until 5 p.m. When Columbia Mall merchants opened their gates last Sunday, they weren't disappointed. The turnout was comparable to an average weekday. The Sunday opening is expected to attract not only area shoppers, but more Canadians as well.
We're expecting a lot of business, a lot of the Canadians to stay down for the weekend. It's probably going to hurt during weekly sales, but the weekend sales are really going to be big. possibly, you know, more stores will stay open and maybe new businesses opening up. And, you know, it's really going to help. I think it's really going to help them all a lot.
I think it's going to be bad for Winnipeg, which is where I'm from. I think people will pour here.
The reaction in Grand Forks has been generally positive. Some employees think it's a disadvantage to work on Sunday, but they enjoy the income created by the extra jobs and hours. The advantages include keeping Sunday shoppers in the state and generating revenue for North Dakota's sagging economy. But not everyone favors the new law. A referral drive to overturn it is underway, and it could be repealed in 1992. That's this morning's news, Tom.
All right, Ann. Good news from the Middle East. We are thrilled to hear it. Way to go, Ann. Stephanie Odegard joins us for some weather information. And Steph, we knew we were going to get a cold blast after we got that warm weather.
It came hard.
We're going to get to that in a minute. Rich Glas, Jean Roebuck both join us. Very rarely, folks, do you ever get to see a basketball program, both men's and women's, that are making such a strong run for a national title. Very rarely do you ever see it.
They've done a good job. They must have a positive effect. The men do well, in turn, the women do well, and vice versa. So they're really playing on each other and doing a good job this season.
Yeah, and I'm curious to find that out, folks, if it's contagious, if they kind of play off each other. We'll find out about that. What about it? Are we going to get some more warm weather or cold weather?
Well, I don't know. The groundhog definitely made a good call last week as he went down back underground. Temperatures have dropped substantially, and we've got some snow on the ground to show for that change. Across the nation, things are looking this way. There's some light rain in the upper northwest caused by a front moving in into shore. Foggy conditions in the northern Rockies, and it's going to be relatively dry today in the southwest. Some heavy lake effect snows coming off the Great Lakes are bringing some large accumulations of snow to places like Cleveland, Ohio, South Bend, Indiana. They've both got 9 inches and are expecting some more today. In the northeast, temperatures are relatively mild, but moving south, they're seeing some nasty conditions in Atlanta, Georgia. There's some scattered snow today, and Florida is preparing for a freeze tonight. In our area, temperatures are looking this way. It's minus 17 in International Falls. Duluth is at minus 12. It's 7 below in Minneapolis-St. Paul. It's minus 18 in Winnipeg, minus 2 in Madison. In South Dakota, Sioux Falls is at minus 17, and Pierre is at minus 15. In Minot, it's minus 4, minus 4 in Bismarck, and 12 below in Fargo. Currently in Grand Forks, it's a cool minus 14 degrees Fahrenheit. Winds out of the west at 5 miles per hour. Our humidity is at 56%. Today our highs should reach 5 to 10 degrees. Winds out of the west 10 to 20 miles per hour. And precipitation 20% chance. Tonight our low is going to be 5 degrees. Winds out of the south at 10 to 20 miles per hour. And a 20% chance of some snow. Our extended outlook, a little warmer Saturday, some cloudy skies, 25 to 30 for our temps. Sunday, a little more sun and 25 to 30 for our temperatures.
So this is just a passing thing.
Well, it's getting a little better.
Great.
Slowly.
3-day weekend plan? Anywhere?
I'm going to head to Duluth, I think.
You drive safe, Steph.
Thanks.
Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
It is coming up on 8 minutes after the hour. And sports headlines from last night. As we head into the stretch run in college basketball, no one seems to be running better right now than the Rebels of UNLV. Last night, Vegas had no problem remaining perfect after 21 games with a win over UC Santa Barbara in top 25 play. Larry Johnson made his first 7 shots en route to a 27-point performance in a 98-71 Rebels victory. A thriller in Madison, Wisconsin. Jimmy Jackson scored 21 and Mark Baker banked in the winner with 1 second remaining to lift second-ranked Ohio State by the Badgers 73-71. In the NBA, the Suns finally stopped David Robinson. Tom Chambers tossed in 37 to lead Phoenix past San Antonio for the first time in 7 tries since Robinson joined the Spurs. The final, 106-97. Sliding to the ice, Wayne Gretzky assisted on 2 goals, including Marty McSorley's tiebreaker in the third, as the 2 former Oilers burned their former team in a 4-2 Kings victory. Switching back to the NBA, don't be surprised if Detroit Pistons coach Chuck Daly is today named the head coach of the 1992 U.S. Olympic basketball team. And more big bucks in baseball. Former Blue Jays first baseman Fred McGriff has agreed to a 4-year, $15.2 million contract with the San Diego Padres. The deal also includes, you ready for this, a $1 million signing bonus. As we go to this break, here's last night's scores on a roll. You're watching Studio One.
Getting to the point where the only thing as dependable as my car problems was done. Every day he'd show up and offer to give me a boost, and I hardly even knew this guy. Well, anyway, I decided to get rid of the old beast and buy a car that I could depend on. I was in the bank to apply for a loan, and you'll never guess who I ran into. And I knew I was in the right place.
Community National Bank. We care about you.
Some people think Social Security is just for retirement.
But if a serious illness or injury puts you out of work, Social Security can pay disability.
Even if you're years from retirement.
And it would pay your family survivor's benefits if somehow your life gets cut short.
So what benefits can you expect? Find out by calling 1-800-2345-SSA.
For your own personal earnings and benefit estimate statement. Social Security is not just for retirement.
It's for life.
Every year, thousands of babies die from choking, suffocating, or other breathing emergencies. Just imagine how many of them could be saved if only they came with instructions. Please learn American Red Cross infant and child CPR. American Red Cross, we help you help others.
At the very time the Persian Gulf War is showing us the importance of superior science and the president is calling for new technological development, there's also a new warning and growing concern today that the number of American researchers is shrinking and our scientific leadership is threatened. Neil Rosenauer has this report.
New American technology seen in the sophisticated weapons of the Gulf War and in the life-saving medications used to treat its casualties, all developed from laboratories like this and from the work of American scientists. But a new Gallup poll reveals growing anxiety among scientists. 94% of university research leaders now predict the scientific preeminence we have come to rely on may soon be a thing of the past, a disappointing start for the 21st century. Part of the problem? Fewer students entering biomedical research, a trend confirmed by two-thirds of research and development directors and over 80% of academic research leaders and grant recipients from the National Institutes of Health.
The concern that we may be losing scientists is immediate because it can take up to 8 years to produce a fully qualified scientist even after the first college degree. That means if we don't have the incentives and we don't have the research opportunities, we clearly are going to diminish one of our most valuable assets, our scientific brain power.
One of the most important areas of research affected is the life sciences, a key source of medical advances such as new drug therapies. Yet nearly 80% of all those surveyed perceive that many scientists, especially young ones, are giving up on biomedical research. And this young Chicagoan is an example of why. Matthew Keast is now studying podiatry after giving up a promising career in biomedical research almost halfway through his dissertation.
I saw the writing on the wall. It's tough to get grants. The salary for postdocs and junior faculty is low. I had a friend who was a postdoc for 10 years. It's 15 years of experience, and he was only making $18,000 a year. Now, I don't mind putting in the time and the hours, but I needed some sort of a better lifestyle for my wife and my daughter. And so I made the switch into medicine, and I don't think I'd go back into research unless there's a little bit more security in the future.
To attract and keep scientists, ranking experts agree students need to be better trained and motivated in math and science as early as junior and senior high school. And from graduate school on, they need solid financial support to do the scientific research itself.
We're facing a significant shortage in the coming decade and an explosion of opportunities. So we simply must attract more young people into science and keep them there with strong, stable support.
It's a question of where we in this country want scientific and technological superiority to reside. If it's here, we need to take some immediate steps to strengthen our future supply of scientific brain power.
In Washington, this is Neil Rosenau reporting.
It's 14 minutes after the hour. From hardware to the hardwood, we'll talk basketball with Rich Glas and Gene Roebuck after this.
Child abuse is also known by some other words.
Jerk! You moron!
You're so clumsy.
Words like these can hit as hard as a fist.
I wish you were never born.
I hate
you.
What you say to your children can determine how they feel about themselves.
You slob. You're worthless.
And how they feel about you. Get the picture. Stop using words that hurt. Start using words that help. For helpful information, contact us.
Lesson 1. Never schedule a cross-country flight the weekend before a big midterm. Lesson 2. Never take off without your flight computer. Lesson 3. No matter what the circumstance is, never, ever drink and drive.
There was a time when people helped their neighbors, and together they built a stronger community. This spirit lives on today in NeighborWorks, a unique partnership of local residents, business, and government leaders. NeighborWorks volunteers have rebuilt over 100,000 homes, restoring pride to millions of neighbors. So help a neighbor and a nation. Join NeighborWorks, reversing decline, rebuilding pride.
Last year's Fighting Sioux basketball program was such a surprising success, most thought it would be hard for men's and women's to repeat the same result. Well, think again. In fact, things are only getting better. This morning, UND is ranked first nationally in Division II men's basketball. The women are ranked seventh nationally and tied for first in the NCC. Men's head coach Rich Glas and women's head coach Gene Roebuck both join us this morning. Gentlemen, congratulations. It is quite a fantastic year, isn't it?
Thank you. Yeah, we're having a good time. We hope it continues.
Gene, any truth to the fact that this winning may be a little bit contagious?
Well, first of all, Rich was mentioning earlier, I think our basketball programs, I think, really get along well. And I think, we go on the court first, and I know Rich's team supports us. And after we get done, we support Rich's teams. And I think, being the fact that we do get along well, I think really helps.
The two of you confiding in each other more as the season progresses, Rich, do you find that?
Well, I think we're in our own little worlds as far as our teams are concerned, but there's that camaraderie of one coach talking to another as far as how are things going, what's happening, but the X's and O's, he does his thing and we pretty much do ours.
Gene, last year you lost your leading scorer. You had tremendous success last year. You come into this season as if you haven't even missed a beat. Is the focus and drive still the same, or has it changed?
Well, I think it's still the same. I mean, we had four starters back. We only lost one player. We did lose our leading scorer, but it was our only player that we lost. So I think the fact that we're more experienced, we have four starters back, and they've been through the war. And now I think when it gets down to crunch time, we don't get flustered. I think that's a situation now where we have had some tight games, and our veterans have come through, so I think we're handling it well.
Rich, same hold true for the men?
We were a little younger this year, actually. We graduated Solomon and Mike Boshi last year, and their loss, I think, has kind of depleted some of the experience factor, and we've got some younger kids in there, so we're having a problem putting people away. We have a tendency to get up by 10, 12, and then let's not put them away and make the coach get a little nervous here at the end of the game and the fans. And I'm hoping that our maturity here the last month of the season when we get into the playoffs will increase, and when we get a team down, we can keep them there and not worry about the comebacks that seem to occur on us all the time. But I think a lot of that's due to the youth factor. We just haven't got a lot of experience back, but the experience we do have is awfully effective in Rico and Scott Gulseth and Dave Onish.
Rich, going into tonight's game against Mankato State, you have a 5-game lead, a pretty comfortable lead. Is it more difficult then to stay focused on the immediacy of the games rather than looking ahead to postseason?
Well, in actuality, we're playing Morningside now.
I'm sorry, so, Morningside.
Yeah, we've already played Mankato twice. We don't want to
beat
them again.
But you've got the 5-game lead on Mankato State.
We do
State,
have
right?
that 5-game lead, and Morningside is also in second place. So they're a team that we need to get after and hope put behind us. And we need to just approach each game as one at a time. When you start thinking, geez, we got a 4-game bulge, you have a tendency to maybe let up a little bit. And our theme is right now dominate. We want to dominate the league. We want to maintain the win streak and not get into a situation where once you lose a couple, then the pressure mounts. Boy, we got to get one more to clinch it. we just hope to go out against Morningside tonight and take care of business and guarantee ourselves at least a share of the title, and then Saturday night against South Dakota, win it outright.
And Gina, on the other side, Morningside Women's comes in at 0-11 in conference play. With a record like that, are you, and I'm not, I know you're not going to give an easier effort, but are you able then to maybe experiment with a little bit more?
Well, first of all, I'd like to be in Rich's position. I don't think we're in any position to experiment. Basically, we've got to win one game at a time and then, you know, take care of our own business. So I like to tell my players, you know, we're in a conference battle right now, and I believe every team has the capabilities of beating you if you really don't go out and play the type of basketball you're capable of. So we're not going to experiment. We're going to go out and try to win the game.
Do they set a tone, Rich, for you? When the women's leaves the floor, they've done well, you guys go out. Is there a tone set?
Yeah, I think there is. You know, it's a matter of our guys are in the locker room and we're waiting for the game, and when we come in, you know, how much are they ahead? What are they up by? And there's an excitement for them to win, but there's also, I think, a feeling, well, they got her done, now we got to go get her done. And the other thing they do is they do two things. They get the crowd revved up, you know, because the crowd's already there and ready to go. But the other thing I think they do is sometimes they wear them out, you know. They get up and down, they get a lot of cheering. Now by the time we get out there, their fans are all tired. So we got to tell him to slow it down a little bit.
Yeah, who owes who what?
Yeah.
We're going to break for this and more with Rich Glas and Gene Roebuck after this.
Just a fraction of what we spend dining out could help pick up the tab for a good cause. A small part of what we spend on sports could help keep our community in shape. Or some of our time on the phone could help answer society's problems. Won't you get involved? By giving 5% of your income and volunteering 5 hours per week, you can really help your community. This year, make it your goal to give 5. What you get back is immeasurable.
Lesson 1. Always be on good terms with your linemen. Lesson 2. Be sure you and the coach are on the same page. Lesson 3. No matter what the circumstance is, never ever drink and drive.
We are talking with Sioux basketball head coaches Rich Glas and Gene Roebuck. I'm not wishing anything like this on you tonight, but let me give you a hypothetical. If for some reason tonight's game, either of you and your assistant coaches were unable to coach tonight's game, Rich, is it possible for you to step in and coach the women's? Gene, would it be possible for you to come in and coach the men's? And Rich, tell me the adjustments that you'd have to make to do that. Gene, I want you to be thinking because you're next.
Well, I think from the standpoint of X's and O's, if I could sit down with a Gene and know what he was planning to do, that would not be as big a problem, because the game itself is the same between the men and women as far as screens, ball handling, passing, the attack that you want to use offensively and defensively against your opponent. I think where the key factor would be is the mental standpoint, or how about the emotions of coaching women as opposed to coaching men. I've not coached women. I don't know what the tone is there, as opposed to the men's team. So I would be in the little dark, from that standpoint. But X's and O's, how we attack a zone, how we get after a player who's hot and want to stop them, that would be similar, because we do essentially the same things. The emotional part, mental part, I'd have to worry about that one a little bit.
Gene?
Well, I kind of like it because, I give the ball to Rico and run that little play Rich runs where I think he gives it to, Rico gives it to Galseth, and then Rico goes off a high post pick and dunks it.
Yeah.
And, you know, for once it'd be fun to coach a dunk. But Realistically, I coach college baseball, and there isn't a lot of difference between coaching guys and coaching ladies. Basically, you coach them the same way. They're athletes, and that's the way I approach it. You know, when they step on the court, I want my players to be athletes. When they step off the court, I want them to be ladies. So as far as the X's and O's go, you know, I think it's a little different coaching guys when you're playing up around the rim than when you're coaching ladies, you know, who don't play around the rim. But as far as the emotional part of it, I think they both get themselves ready to play, and they both accept coaching, and I don't think that would be difficult for me.
Gene, from the player's perspective, how is it approached, a male coaching women's basketball? What do you think are the advantages and disadvantages from their perspective?
Well, I know going out in the recruiting world, you have some recruits that want to play for men coaches and some recruits that want to play for women coaches. But I don't think there's really any difference in coaching as far as, I think that was your question, as far as the women coaching and the men coaching. I think players respond to positive coaching, and I think there are some times when you got to be a little negative, but I think that just is the way all coaches coach, so I don't think there's really a difference.
We are talking about differences, and let's shift gears to Division I and Division II basketball. Rich, you guys are in good company, being first in the country in Division II. Division I, UNLV on top. How great is the talent difference there? And let me ask you, is it growing larger or is it growing less, the talent gap, if I can use that?
Well, if you compare us and UNLV, I think UNLV is in a whole different world, but they're also in a whole different world with all the other Division I teams too, so we wouldn't be in bad company in that way. It would be difficult for us to day in and day out go up and compete against the top level of Division I competition. But there's a lot of Division I programs that I feel that we would be able to compete with very well against, because those programs aren't going to go beat the UNLVs or the Ohio States or the Missouris or the Kansas programs either. The NCAA Division I level has some elite teams and elite programs that are constantly in that battle for the number one position. As far as Division II, I feel that the University of North Dakota has the opportunity to be one of those elite programs in Division II basketball. I think we could compete with a number of conferences and teams in Division I. But why be in the middle or lower echelon when you can be at the top of the echelon? So we enjoy the Division II competition. I don't think the difference between Division I and Division II is increasing or coming closer together. I think it's been pretty much the same. It depends on our ability to get some of those Division I players to play for a Division II school like the University of North Dakota. And when you have those players, you're going to be a top-level Division II basketball program, and we hope to be able to maintain that level.
Gene, have you found in the offseason recruiting much easier with a winning program?
Oh, definitely. You know, you get recruits that are out of our area that will look towards the University of North Dakota just because of, number one, you know, academically we have their program, but number two, the fact that we're a ranked team in the top 10 kind of catches their eye.
Rich Glas, Gene Roebuck, a pleasure having the two of you on. Congratulations
you.
On a terrific year.
Thank you.
Anxious to see the outcome of tonight and tomorrow night. The
so
best
are
to
we.
You guys.
Yeah.
I bet you are. Thanks again, guys. It is coming up on 29 minutes after the hour. We have much more up ahead in our second half hour of Studio One. But first, this break.
It's time for You Lost Your Life with your host, Crash Dummies, Vince and Larry.
Hi.
Hello. And welcome to the show that proves if you don't buckle your safety belt, the loser is you.
That's right, Vince. And by not buckling up, you could end up in places you never dreamed.
Like traction.
Or the emergency room.
Plus, Larry, if you're not buckled up, you could maybe take a ride in a beauty like this. Stay tuned.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
Hey, how you doing?
Look what I do in school today, Grandpa.
The harp. The aorta, the left and right ventricles, and the auricles.
Grandpa, Did you want to be a doctor when you were little?
Well,
dreams need never again be forgotten.
You would have been the best doctor, Grandpa.
Please support the United Negro College Fund.
Can I be a doctor, Grandpa?
Every year, thousands of people are killed with a frying pan. Reduce your intake of high-fat fried foods and help reduce your risk of cancer and heart disease. For a free booklet on low-fat eating, call 1-800-EAT-LEAN.
We are just about on the verge of a three-day weekend, at least for some of you. President's Day will be observed on Monday, which is a federal holiday. We're glad you're with us. I'm Tom Buring. You know, one sign of a successful and growing operation is when you periodically have to check in to keep up with a new development. We'll check in with the Center for Aerospace Sciences at the University of North Dakota. They house the country's best aviation program and have the international contracts to prove it. John Odegard, Dean and founder of the Center for Aerospace, will join us. We'll also look at the world of fashion and image making through the perspective of an image maker, a successful image maker. Canada's Peter Nygaard of Nygaard International is our subject on today's Fashion Page. First things first, and Anne Kurian joins us with details on this morning's news. Good morning, Anne.
Good morning, Tom. Writing Across the Curriculum is a news writing program available to all academic departments at the University of North Dakota. The Bush Foundation will give UND $100,000 a year for the next 3 years to set up the program. Coordinator Joan Hawthorne says the integration of writing skills into various subjects is a national trend. To date, the program has integrated writing skills into accounting and engineering programs. The program responds to the belief that writing skills should not be separated from the learning process. More effective communication skills are required in today's job market. Writing Across the Curriculum resources are available to all faculty members who wish to integrate writing skills into their classes. 21 student pilots from the Republic of China graduated last week from a unique flight training program at UND. Feline Duraney reports the training won't end with the initial 16-month program.
China Airline Class No. 3 graduated after rigorous pilot training at UND's International Aviation Program, Spectrum. The pilots logged over 300 flight hours and over 1,000 classroom hours during their stay in Grand Forks. Flight group leader David Tai says he was proud to be part of the UND program and felt he gained valuable experience.
We need to come here to build up our flying time. Then when we go home, then we can qualify to be a qualified pilot in our country.
The Cal 3 class will continue in the Advanced Spectrum program on February 20th. Advanced Spectrum is an intensive year of over 600 hours of airline experience for qualified Spectrum pilots. Center of Aerospace Sciences Dean John Odegard says the program was designed for China Airlines, but will be open to other qualified pilots in late 1991.
And we will now offer the advanced program, which will give their pilots that have been trained through the Spectrum program the additional experience of being qualified as regional airline pilots.
China Airline President Peter Bin says he's excited to begin the new program and realizes new ground is being broken with the five-year contract and expects over 100 jobs to be created across North Dakota. He says North Dakota has the best facility and the experience the pilots will gain is incomparable.
They need the airline experience. They need many years to become a good pilot. And I feel confident that this new Advanced Spectrum program will help us to train highly qualified pilots.
John Odegard hopes the Spectrum pilot training program will continue to meet the challenge of an international pilot shortage. Feline Duraney, Studio One News.
The University of North Dakota is sponsoring a campus-wide health and fitness fair. February 10th through the 15th is Wellness Week at UND. Participants are involved in a variety of recreational activities, lectures, presentations, and workshops. Displays were set up in UND's Memorial Union to provide information on health issues such as body fat, cholesterol, and stress. Wellness Committee member James Whitehead says the committee will evaluate the week to determine if the fair will continue at UND. Whitehead says the Wellness Committee is optimistic and the fair appears to be going well. That's this morning's news, Tom.
Anne, thank you. Have a good weekend. Still up ahead, John Odegard and the Center for Aerospace's impact on the airline industry. You know, whether we like the idea or not, you and I promote the image clothing manufacturers want to project by what we wear. Ever wonder who these image makers are and how they determine what they want to sell? Peter Nygaard would be one of them. In 1967, he took control of a women's sportswear company and renamed it Tanger. Nygaard International is now the largest clothing manufacturer in Canada, with annual sales exceeding $250 million. Peter Nygaard and Nygaard International, our topic on today's Fashion Page.
I think the fun part of this whole business is fashion, and fashion is image making. You know, the word fashion itself has to do with constant change and the perception of what is in and what is the thing to wear and what is the latest thing to wear, and it's the concept of continually changing and really building an obsolescence. You know, there's nothing more obsolete than a wardrobe, woman's wardrobe particularly. I mean, a woman has a closet full of clothes and get nothing to wear. You know, so it's a wonderful business. So fashion is, in fact, a standard of living that the North American and the European consumers have, and it's an expression of that.
From your position, Peter, do you ever question that, the priority of it? Is it overemphasized in the U.S. or in Canada?
No, it's that's what gives us those thrills in life, you know. That's what, well, take that away from particularly a woman, and you know, you got a pretty unhappy woman, you know. So why try to talk ourselves into a Chinese culture where everybody uses the same uniform type of thing? I mean, this is exactly what separated us from developing nations, is that we can put wonderful clothes on. And of course, you can have wonderful houses and wonderful cars, but when you get to the clothing, that's the most important thing for the woman, particularly. Feed it. And this is what gives us the thrill and a change of clothing, and you feel so wonderful and good. You can't suppress that kind of feeling. It's a natural feeling.
Whose image are you selling, or whose image do you sell?
Well, it has to come to a lot to the image that I perceive our company to have and perceive the woman who's wearing our clothes to have. It's carefully cultivated from what is generally out there, you know, other people's feeling towards this so-called image. But I definitely take a specific approach to it and say, okay, I don't want to reject certain parts of other people's image making, and we build our own on it. And we sort of identify our own customer and see what she would look the best in, and then build an image for her. So it really comes from our own designing group's creative think tank type of feeling, you know, and into that is fed thousands of pieces of information, you know, and then comes out this image.
I would imagine somebody in your position selling a bit of your perspective to the public, somebody in your position has got to be pretty secure about who they are and what they're doing. True?
Well, I've never lacked from confidence, I guess, if that's what you're asking. You never get completely secure. You know, you know, as you get older and supposedly wiser, you find out you know less and less. And particularly in this industry, it's not a secure industry. I think what you have to do in industry is act like you're secure. You know, there's so much insecurity, the retailers, the consumers, that if you come out positive and secure and sort of reflect that, that's what they're looking. That's one of the big issues of selling. Selling a product is the total convincing that you are right to know what the hell you're doing about. But it would be naive to say that I would think that I'm always right. You know, it makes you pretty humble fast. You know.
When we talk about having an eye for apparel, how much of that is instinct? How much of that is developed?
You have to be born with it, just like a good race runner, or with good athlete, or a good singer. Then you develop it. You know, you develop it on your history and by studying other people's work and by studying your own work and by studying the market trends and by doing market research. But instinctively, you have to have some sixth sense about it. You have to have a taste of fashion or creativity, and then you have to develop that.
How have women changed, say, over the last 10, 15 years?
They got more quality-oriented, much more. They prepared to pay a lot more, not even a little bit more, a lot more for just that one right thing instead of getting volumes of the product. I think they're much more quality-oriented. The North American woman is quickly catching up with the European woman. I say catching up because the European woman has spent a lot more money on clothes per item than North American has. And we're quickly finding in this country too that we just can't send volumes of polyester pants. We want that one great blazer made of cashmere or something, you know, and we'd rather pay $500 for that than buy six outfits that are $50 a piece or something, you know. So there is now a real fine tuning going on, you know, sweeping the country. And I don't think we've ever gone through a bigger fashion revolution than we are going right through. Now there's a big change going on right now in the marketplace.
Peter Nygaard of Nygaard International. It's 20 minutes before the hour. When we return with Studio One, the pilot behind the best aviation training program in the country, maybe the world, we'll find out next.
You strive every day to be your best. But even after all your hard work and practice and dedication, there's nothing like getting a hand to help you succeed. When it comes to meeting your financial goals, many times all it takes is that little extra helping hand from people who really care. People like Community National Bank. Community National Bank. We care about you.
There are people out there who need help, but don't have anyone with the right skills and knowledge to turn to for help with their taxes. You or your organization can be there for someone who needs help. Volunteer your time, and the IRS will volunteer the training to help make someone's taxes less taxing.
The animals in the forest. If they could talk, what would they say? They might say, "Be careful with fire in the forest." Just like Smokey says, only you can prevent forest fires.
Quite remarkable what the last 22 years have brought for the University of North Dakota's aviation program. Just last week, John Odegard, dean and founder for the Center for Aerospace Sciences, saw 21 students from Taiwan graduate from their training program to eventually return to fly for China Airlines. John, good morning, and that is quite an accomplishment, a sign of the times. But let me put you on the spot here, and I'm sorry I'm going to have to do this, but I'm real curious to know if you could single out one and only one accomplishment that best captures the mission for the Center for Aerospace Science. What would it be?
Oh, Tom, that's a terrible question. It's really hard. Let me tell you why that's difficult. There are a number of things that are going on in CAS. What we just did last week with the graduation of the Spectrum program is a major focus within CAS for our aviation students from the standpoint that the Spectrum development took well over 2 years and an awful lot of money for us to design with the help of Northwest Airlines. How are we going to prepare the future pilots, not just for the nation, but for the whole world, to be serving in the airlines. And so what we have now successfully done with Spectrum and the launching of the Advanced Spectrum program is certainly a major highlight in CAS. But we've got a number of wonderful things going on. We just received, after several years of very hard work, from our Space Studies Department, we received the designation as a Space Grant University. Now, that's one of the few Space Grant universities in the United States, and that ties after the old land grant universities that helped establish much of higher education across the United States. Our designation as a Space Grant University is going to be very important for the state of North Dakota and certainly the university. So that's a major thing. And we have a lot of exciting things happening in atmospheric sciences and other parts of CAS as well. So tough question.
Yeah. The Space Grant Program is to really educate young kids, isn't it?
Well, that's just one part of it. I think the most important thing it does is that it designates the University of North Dakota as the Space Grant Institution for the state of North Dakota. What does that mean? NASA, for example, has a very large number of programs that are going to be developing the whole space program in the United States. The space program, as it develops, the commercialization of space that spins off from that will be a major part of our economy by the turn of the century. We wanted to position UND and certainly the Center for Aerospace Sciences to be ready to receive some of that money from NASA. You know, they spend billions and billions of dollars every year. I think last year, the state of North Dakota received something like $21,000 total. Mm-hmm. California got billions of dollars. So we've never been in position, neither at the university or, more importantly, the whole state of North Dakota, to be a part of the space program. And the fact is, we have a lot of things going on, and now with the focus for the Center for Aerospace Sciences, we want to be in position from a standpoint of education, from the standpoint of the development of the commercialization of space, and from the standpoint of economic development for the state of North Dakota to start doing something with the federal government. We want to get our fair share. We want to be a part of the program. The space grant designation does that for us.
And I can't help but think that it will also help in recruiting. Is aviation easy to recruit for?
Well, it is easy to recruit for from the standpoint that the aviation program itself at UND is very unique. We have students from every state in the United States and about 31 foreign countries that are here going to school. And so recruiting is not a large problem. However, we are always recruiting from the standpoint that we want the best and the brightest from all over the world. And so, you know, you never let up on recruiting. As far as the space grant designation, that's important because our space grant program and our master's in space studies is in fact unique in the country. It's brand new, and so this helps publicize the program throughout the country, and it will help us with NASA and NSF and other federal agencies that are part of the space program.
And the perks just keep kicking in. Grand Forks gets a regional air service.
Well, we're in the closing days of putting that thing together, and that's going to be very exciting because, as you're aware, we graduated another Spectrum class from China Airlines this last weekend, and 1 week from now, the first class of advanced Spectrum students will arrive back in Grand Forks from Taiwan, and they will start training to be ready to fly this regional airline and to fly as a co-pilot on the regional airline. That airline should kick off in North Dakota sometime in May. And that's important because we have a real transportation problem in the state. It's long ways from the east to the west and north to the south, and there is no air service. And so for the first time in many, many, many years, actually since deregulation, our concept is that we're going to have the opportunity that any of us can leave from any of the eight major cities in North Dakota, travel to another city, conduct a day of business, and come back again. And in addition to that, we'll tie into Canada, Minnesota, and South Dakota. Now, you know, that has a major economic development impact for North Dakota because it helps us then attract industries in. But of course, I think our primary interest and our major concern is what does that do for the University of North Dakota? What does it do for the kids in the aviation program? And it's going to be a wonderful thing for them because our aviation graduates are going to be the young people who will be the captains flying those airplanes, and the crews, and the managers. And so it will create a lot of opportunity. In fact, we're estimating it'll initially create over 100 jobs. And since we know we train some of the best qualified young people in the country, they're going to be ready for them.
Yeah, when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about those pilots, where they are and what they're doing. More with John Odegard when Studio One continues.
this thing working? At this sales presentation, I would like to show you our new facility. Can you see this up there? Take my word for it. It's really neat.
Everyone makes mistakes, Matthew. Don't pay any attention to the other children.
For this bright six-year-old, the ABCs have never been as simple as ABC. Where do you go when you're different from the other kids? He got help at a center for learning disabilities. They got help from the United Way. All because the United Way got help from you. The United Way. It brings out the best in all of us.
Randy Travis on strings. Branford Marsalis on the horn. Paul Schaefer on keys. Carly Simon on lead. There are a lot of different parts to play in the American Red Cross. Play your part.
We're talking with John Odegard, Dean of the Center for Aerospace Sciences at UND. John, let's see how full circle sometimes things come. You ever stepped on a plane commercially and fly, and while you're flying or when you get off, you realize it's a UND student flying?
Not only do I do that, that's almost a daily occurrence when I fly now, because so many of our graduates are flying for airlines. And I frequently, as I step onto the airplane, they'll recognize who I am and come and introduce themselves. Sometimes I don't even know them. But I remember that we had one occasion here not too terribly long ago where Piedmont Airlines had a DC-9 crew that recently, of course, Piedmont is now a part of US Air, but the DC-9 crew all showed up in operations. And they received their bids and they were ready to go on their first flight. All of the people came together and they looked at each other, and it turned out to be Becky Rose, who was one of our graduates and the first female pilot for Piedmont and a captain in a DC-9, another UND student who was a young lady who was the co-pilot, and three flight attendants, all UND graduates. So they got a picture of them because we had an all-UND, all-female crew flying this DC-9 over on the East Coast. So it's a small world, and these young people are doing extremely well.
Cutting-edge material, and that's almost what CAS seems to thrive on, isn't it, John?
Well, we do. We have a lot of very intelligent people in CAS, and I'm blessed to be surrounded with a lot of people that are far smarter than I'll ever be. And they do a marvelous job, and many of them are motivated to stay on the cutting edges of technology and what's happening. We have a technology instructional research lab that's working in the latest video interactive, laser-based, artificial intelligent, computer-based instruction techniques. In fact, we're about to launch a new master's degree that will specialize on that, that will tie into a lot of the international work we're doing with other airlines. And that connects to our distant learning facility, which is now under construction, and building's all built, and the equipment is about to be ordered for the first phase of that. That will be a very large project. It'll have a total budget that will exceed $14 million over a five-year period. It'll be close to $7 million worth of equipment. And we're teamed up with IBM. That's a real fun thing.
You'd be packaging curriculum, more or less drawing a good scenario of what's going on here, getting it out to other campuses. How much of a demand is there, John, for that?
Well, there's a growing demand from the standpoint that this primarily is being designed for the Airway Science Program. And there are now roughly 50 universities across the country that have Airway Science programs. Some of them are smaller. And there, in fact, is a meeting next week in Washington where we're now looking at two-year Airway Science programs across the country, and then there will be several hundred. So the idea that we and the FAA and IBM came up with together was, let's build a facility at the University of North Dakota and let's equip it to be a state-of-the-art on the cutting edge of distant learning. Let's have the newest, finest of all the equipment that are available, and we will then be able to teach via satellite or via video mm-hmm. to all of these other schools across the country. So we intend to tie UND mm-hmm. as a hub to all the airway science schools across the United States. and probably to quite a few foreign countries.
And there could be a lot of spin-offs off of that. How fast does the change occur in aviation? The technology, the equipment, when does it get obsolete? Too fast for you?
No, it's never too fast for us. But actually what happens is the industry itself has a difficult time keeping up with the speed of the advancements of technology. For example, the entire air traffic control system that's tied up in the bureaucracy and the whole modernization of ATC, which is a $25 billion project that's currently going on. That's happening very, very slowly, while at the same time, we've got brand new fly-by-wire, totally automated, artificial intelligence-based airline aircraft that are now flying. They're flying, in fact, into North Dakota in some places with Airbus 320s. We're flying a supersonic airplanes back and forth for 18 years in the form of the Concorde, and now the British and the French are ready to launch what they call the Son of Concorde, a 350-passenger Mach 3, three times the speed of sound airplane. So the technology is just roaring ahead, and there's some tremendous advancements. The most difficult thing is developing programs to educate the people to keep up with technology. Mm-hmm.
John, it's a hard challenge just to keep up with you guys over at CAS. Terrific work you're doing. And we're going to have you on soon so you can update us.
Thanks, Tom.
That's John Odegard. We need to let you go. We've enjoyed having you with us. Have fun with your weekend, folks. It's going to be a three-day weekend. If you're traveling over the holiday, drive safe. Take care of yourself. For Ann Curian and Stephanie Odegard, I'm Tom Buring. We'll see you again next week. Bye-bye.